So you've said that Japan is the only market at the moment where you're not making money. Obviously, you have to be here, but when do you think the Japanese market's going to turn around for you, and what are the models that are going to help drive that?
I think you have two things. First, you have the internal market of Japan, and then you have the exports from Japan. When I was talking about the fact that we were not making money, that it did not make sense for us to have cars exported from Japan with the level of the yen where it is. So this is where we are struggling today, which obviously means that more and more these exports, instead of being done from Japan to other countries, are going to be taking place in China or in Thailand or in Mexico for other places. But our profitability on the Japanese market is okay. I mean, when you are producing in yen and selling in yen, you're in good shape. The problem is when you are producing in yen and selling in another currency, this is where you're facing a problem.
You said you talked to Prime Minister Noda about this. Have you seen evidence? I mean, we've had a little bit of intervention, but any long-term move to weaken the yen so that you can keep production
here?
You
know, we are business people. What we are looking for is not tentatives and efforts. We're looking for results. So far, we don't see results. We are still at 77 yen to the dollar, which we consider highly uncompetitive and absolutely a big handicap for exporters. We're still there.
If we stay like this for years to come, how much are you going to reduce your production here in Japan and ramp it up in places like Brazil?
Well, you know, we're gonna be making decisions on investments all the time. Every time you have a new project coming, you're gonna have to decide where you're gonna source the project. So as long as the yen is at the uncompetitive level where it is, all the new project that we're going to have to decide will probably are going to go in other country, and we're going to be moving like this in the future. And I don't think it's something which is typical of Nissan. I think this is something that you're going to see with all the major exporters of the country.
You're showing off new EVs here. We're standing in front of the S-Flow concept. You've got three new ones. Going forward, what do you see the ideal mix between plug-in hybrid, hybrid, electric, clean diesel for Nissan and for Renault?
Well, I don't think there is an ideal mix. The mix is going to be what the consumers are going to be deciding, and the consumer are going to be deciding on different ground if they are in Japan or in the United States or in China or in Europe. What we want to make sure is that we have the technology, it's ready, and we are able to deliver to the consumer whatever he wants. I personally think that in the first step between now and 2020, we're going to see about 10% of the market made by electric cars.
You describe Leaf as your crisis car because, you know, people want to cut their fuel bill and this is a great car in tough times. So does that mean that you're going to raise your production targets and sales targets? And if so, could you give me an idea of by how much?
Look, usually we do not share sales target and forecast beyond the next year. We are in a strategy of growth. It's obvious. We have announced it. We said that we would like to grow our global market share. And by the way, the global market share has been growing steadily for the last 3 years. Now we are around 6.2% of the global market share. We think our potential is much higher than this, and we're going to pursue it.
What about entry-level cars? You've got the Logan, you've got the Sandero. La Tribune said that you were making a 2,500 euro car. Are there plans for another car for emerging markets, a low-cost entry-level vehicle?
We're talking about Renault here. That is a different angle. We're talking about Renault. Yes, there is a huge market for affordable cars. Between the low-price car, the ultra-low-price car. Why? Because, in fact, you know, people moving to buy a car, at the beginning they want a very affordable car for them to make this move. So you're going to see the underlines is working on many options of low price and ultra low price cars in many markets. So yes, you're going to see much more offer beyond what we are offering today, both from Renault and from Nissan, in order to meet the demand in emerging markets.
You talked after the quake about not relying too much on one production center, and we learned that also from the Thai floods. You're the only one of the big three automakers to actually give full year forecasts and actually increase them. So have you learned anything more, and do you have any more plans to diversify your production bases?
Look, I don't know what our competitors have learned. I know what we have learned, and we are comfortable into making a forecast for the year. This forecast is, there is some kind of risks, but we compensate this risk by some opportunity that we are seeing. So we feel comfortable with the forecast that we have done for the year. There are a lot of lessons that we have learned. You know, every crisis brings you some lessons. That's why, you know, no matter what, you get stronger out of a new crisis because of everything you have learned through this crisis. The tsunami, we learned a lot of things. The flood in Thailand, we learned a lot of things. From the, you know, the recession that took place after the Lehman collapse, we learned a lot of things. And every time the company is getting better and stronger, which by the way, make me optimistic on the fact that companies become extremely resilient no matter what crisis it's facing.
You've got an alliance with Mitsubishi Motors, in fact, sharing facilities in Thailand. What about going forward? Are you looking to make an EV together and work on technology in that direction?
We are really always interested in any cooperation that brings a outcome for our company. And that's why our alliances and cooperations work very well, because we are very pragmatic. We know exactly what we want, and we are building the cooperation around what we want and what our partners want. With Mitsubishi, we have a cooperation on mini cars in Japan, and we have a cooperation around pickup truck in Thailand. That's it. If there are more opportunities, we'll consider them extremely pragmatically, as we're doing it with all our other collaborations.
Suzuki's moving away from VW, it seems. Talk of Toyota moving in with BMW. Any other alliances that you're looking towards?
You know, this is an era of cooperation and exchanges. I always said that. What you're seeing is exactly the translation of this trend, that car makers have to exchange, they have to collaborate, they cannot make it all by themselves. They cannot make all the technologies, they cannot be present in all the markets, and they cannot have all the products. So from time to time, they need to give a hand, you know, or to take the hand of somebody else in order to be present everywhere. And what you're seeing with most of our competitor is the concretization of this trend.
So what markets then is Nissan Renault not in that they want to get into? And you may need a helping hand to get into. You said that you can't be in all markets and you may need a helping hand. So for Nissan Renault, what are those markets? Where?
Well, we cooperate already with Daimler. We are working with Mitsubishi. We are working with AvtoVAZ. So there are plenty of cooperation taking place. AvtoVAZ, in order to be more present in Russia, with Daimler, we are allowing Daimler to benefit from our small car technology. At the same time, we're benefiting from their luxury car technology. So there is a lot of give and take into this cooperation. As long as it is done in a rational way and with respect of different identities, you know, I think this is the name of the game for the industry.